So we're ready and we can begin. So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us for this webinar of Sustainable Development Goals 13. Sustainable Development Goals 13, how can agriculture tackle climate change effects in the Bahamas and the Caribbean? My name is Shikara Lightborn. I am the Acting Country Representative and Technical Specialist at the Inter-American Institute Cooperation on Agriculture in the Bahamas. And I am pleased today to have some very special guests. But before I introduce my guests, I would like to introduce Ms. Jerry Kelly, who's an agricultural officer at the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources in the Bahamas. AICA is working very closely with the government of the Bahamas to try to put into action these sustainable development goals, particularly in climate action, in the wake of some very devastating hurricanes that we've had last year, and that very much devastated our agricultural industries, especially in our twin islands of Grand Bahama and Alco. So without further delay, I'd like to introduce Ms. Jerry Kelly to bring a few remarks on behalf of the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources in the Bahamas. Jerry.
Thank you so much, Shikara. It's a pleasure to be on with you all today. I wish to send a special welcome to you all for today's webinar. Over the past several months, the ministry, in partnership with AICA, have engaged in several climate action activities in support of the climate change policy. As Shikara mentioned, a part of this, we conducted several awareness raising activities on the impacts of climate change on agriculture. And we were able to host some composting and waste management workshops throughout the islands, namely in Grand Bahama, Abaco, Eleuthera, Cat Island, and New Providence. I hope I don't miss anything. But these workshops were important as they taught practices on composting, waste management, and was a measure to assist farmers with mitigating the impacts of climate change through improved soil health, soil quality, and the use of recycling approaches. Today, we hope that we can have an insightful webinar and engage in a lively discussion. Thank you, Shikara, and thank you, Victor.
Thank you very much, Jerry. It's been a pleasure working with the ministry, and we hope to move forward with our project, and as well as we hope to bring as many partners on to collaborate, and it's all about collaboration. And this is actually how we met our guest presenters today, through collaboration and putting out our story as to our challenges in the country. I want to introduce to you Dr. Victor Falguera from Lleida, Spain. Dr. Falguera is an agricultural engineer with a PhD in agriculture and food science and technology from the University of Lleida. He's also a PhD in engineering and advanced technologies from the University of Barcelona. He's an author of more than 40 JCR Index journal articles and several extension articles and contributions to national and international congresses. Dr. Falguera is a consultant and teacher, a lecturer on territorial development strategies and technologies for the agri-food sector. He has been twice awarded with the National Prize for Excellence in Academic Performance of the Ministry of Education of the Spanish government in 2006 and 2008, and with the University of Lleida's PhD Extraordinary Award for his doctoral thesis in 2012. Dr. Falguera has been counsel for education and in 2011 and 2013 and mayor of Albatarec, 2013-2018 in Lleida, Spain. He is the founding member of the companies AQUIS International, where he coordinates with research and development departments, eStratos, Geosystems, and Inaptec Automation. He is a currently part-time lecturer at the University of Lleida and a member of the managing board of the Official Association of Agricultural Engineers in Catalonia. Dr. Falguera has been one of the members of the Spanish Ministry of Agriculture Food Group of Agricultural Knowledge and Innovation. Thank you very much, Dr. Valguera, for your presence here at this webinar. We're very much looking forward to your presentation and your wisdom and technical assistance in this area. So without further delay, let's get on to our presentation for the day.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Shakara and Jerry. Thank you, Shakara, for your nice invitation. It's my pleasure to be here today sharing our thoughts with you. And as we discussed previously, let's look forward to this Q&A session, because as I'm going to try to explain in the next minutes, collaboration is key to achieve these SDGs in general, but and mainly also the SDG 13 about the impact of climate change. I'm going to try to share my screen. I hope you are already seeing the presentation. Okay, so what I will try to explain today is we're going to review the different targets in which the SDG 13 is organized by the own United Nations, and we'll try to get some insights of some tools and strategies that we have inside each one of the targets, and focusing, as I just said, on the collaboration or collaborative opportunities that we can get from each one of the targets and the tools that we are going to review. First of all, let's take a look at the general landscape of the targets. And the SDG 13, as you already know, is split in these five targets. The 13.1 is strengthen resilience and adaptive capacity to climate-related disasters. So it's mainly focused on the adaptive capacity. We are gonna review some tools that we have from the agricultural perspective just to mitigate these effects of climate change. The target 13.2 is about integrating climate change measures into policies and planning and strategies. So we are gonna take a look at how we can develop collaborative strategies to have an impact on policies. And target 13.3 is about building knowledge and capacity to meet climate change. And we are gonna focus on education on the aspects about climate change mitigation and what we can do from the agricultural perspective to help mitigating the climate change and its effects. And then we have a couple of targets that are more related to institutional capacity. 13A is about getting funds, and 13B is about how to implement effective actions that can be funded with these funds. And we'll try to complement the things that we are going to see in these minutes during the presentation with some homework that I'd like to set up for everybody that is listening to us today. And we can later discuss about how to implement or to make this homework done, okay? So let's start from the very beginning. First of all, I'd like to state from a general landscape that when we consider several of the things that we are going to see today in this presentation, we're going to focus on rural territories. And rural territories have a broader perspective than only agriculture, but we are going to focus on agriculture today, as it is the topic of the webinar. But as you will see, we can apply several of the concepts of the ideas that we are going to review also to livestock or to food industry and to the general concept of rural development. But let's today, mainly in the first part of the session, we are going to focus on agriculture. And when it comes to developing the policies and the strategies and to implement some actions to try to get this collaborative work upscaled into the policies and strategies. We can focus on a broader perspective in terms of rural development, which is the ultimate aim of all of us, because we are working on agriculture. We are working on different kinds of services or issues, maybe on technology or in advice or in extension or in research even, just with the aim to help farmers make a living out of their activity and to keep them living and living well in their home. So we are going to focus on agriculture mainly in the first part, but we will try to open up to the other kinds of activities that we can find in rural territories. So let's start with the first target, 13.1. The specific name of this target is strengthen resilience and adaptive capacity to climate-related hazards and natural disasters. And to be honest, it's kind of weird for me to talk about climate-related hazards to an audience that has a lot more than me about this, because you are receiving or suffering the effects in a very harder way than we do here in Europe or in Southern Europe or in Spain. And I'm gonna ask all of you and also the people that is watching today this webinar for some help in the awareness raising activities, which we will review later in the other target. But although we can know some things about the tools that we are going to see to help agriculture adapt to the effects of climate change, we have a social problem yet, which is that the number of deniers of the effects of climate change, of the number of people who is still thinking that climate change may be a real thing, but the effects will come in several years or in a few years. This amount of people is still very, very important. And we, first of all, we have to be very clear on this. We need to make an effort all together to really believe that this is real and the time for acting is now, because the effects are getting worse every year, and these effects will not come in a few years. They are already happening now. So let's see what we can do from the agricultural perspective. We can focus on several aspects about agricultural management, such as soil management, such as the crops, such as crop nutrition, crop protection, and water management. All of this, let me remember this, from the adaptive capacity perspective. So the things that we are going to see in this section is how can we adapt to the effects of climate change from the agricultural perspective, but using certain kind of tools, mainly focused on the management of nutrition and water. Because obviously we have to take important, crucial decisions in the agricultural process to adapt to climate change that have to do, for example, with varieties or crop selection and how we change the crops that we have in a certain area, and how we implement crops that are more adapted to climate change or these ever-changing conditions that we have. Or maybe we could talk about soil management strategies to help in soils to be recovered, to improve their ability to or their resilience to the effects of climate change. For example, in terms of the microbiota of the soils and how the soils can go on helping our crops to grow. But today we are mainly focusing on how we can take advantage of very simple tools to help our farmers, and which collaborative options can we take from each one of them. So we can set up a general process that has to do with the different steps that we have to follow when we use any kind of tool for agriculture. And you will see that this is or can be applied to very, very simple tools and to very complex tools, but the approach must be always the same. And I'm going to try to explain it in a few minutes, a couple of minutes. And so we always have to start with data gathering, which may be very, very challenging, specifically in certain situations as the ones that you have, for example, in the Bahamas, when data gathering, when it comes to certain variables, is very, very difficult because you have a country that is split in several islands and with different conditions and with different kinds of management even and within the same country. So data gathering is not an easy thing to do. And we will see how we can tackle these difficulties. After data gathering, we have a second step, which is validation of this data and analysis of this data. Validation is also crucial, because sometimes we don't have any other chance to take data or to have data that just asking for it to farmers. And this means that the system and the ability of the system to be really useful for its objectives will depend on the attitude of the farmer at the moment of introducing the data to the system, or to say the truth through a cell phone call, for example, or to a survey in a tablet or on a mobile app, for example. So data has to be always validated, and this is not a simple step, because detecting the outliers or the wrong data is not that easy. But we can take advantage of very simple statistical tools. I'm not focusing on this today, because it would be more a thing for technology developers, for example, or just for people from the universities, for example. But we have to keep in mind that this is a very important step. After the analysis, we make decision. So with the analysis, we take the information out of the data, and this information must allow us to take a decision. And the decision must be made by the farmers or by advisors, for example, or by the institutions that help farmers to grow and to go on. After this decision, we must act. And this is also very important, because the decisions that we have to take must be feasible. The farmer must be able to apply all the decisions that we take as advisors, because otherwise the process makes no sense. If we are very, very good and we dedicate a lot of efforts to data gathering, if we do a very, very precise and fine validation and analysis, if we take the best of decisions, but the farmer cannot apply these decisions, we are not doing anything, really. So this is a very, very important aspect that we have to keep in mind previously. And after the actuation, we have to assess the results and the impact of our actions. And how do we assess these results or this impact? By data gathering again. So this is a continuous process. And in most cases, where technology will help or can help us, but technology is only another tool that we can use or not. To enter this process, we don't need any technology farther than maybe this, and this, just a notebook and a pen and our cell phone. And we can do all these steps. We can follow all these steps to help our farmers adapt to the effects of climate change, provided that we have communication and collaboration with them. So technology is optional. Communication and collaboration are not. These are mandatory and will be more important in the next years, because we are starting to realize that technology cannot break certain barriers, but collaboration can. And I will try to focus on this also later. So let's start from the very beginning. This is the best tool that we have to make precision agriculture. I do a lot of training on precision agriculture, and at the beginning, I always say two things. The first one is that precision agriculture is not about technology. Precision agriculture is about agriculture. So we have to know a lot of things about agriculture to be precise. And afterwards, the best tool that we have to make precision agriculture is this, soil augers. Soil augers, and obviously, together with this notebook, because we have to be methodic in data gathering, but we can guess a lot of information just digging holes in the ground. But being methodic, we can know about soil texture, for example, about the organic matter content of the soil, about the interaction of water and the soil solution with our soil and with our plant. We can get a lot of information about this interaction between the soil, the plant, and the atmosphere, just knowing the soil. And for knowing the soil, the best tool that we have is as simple as this, the soil auger. And which is the collaborative opportunity that we get from this tool? Collaborative soil mapping, because soil mapping is very, very hard to do if you have to tackle this situation by yourself, even if you are a big institution, because it requires a lot of field work. And afterwards, you never know when you start planning these things, which are the most important areas to map. So from the upper perspective or from a broader perspective, we can plan to do a very simple collaborative soil mapping, but obviously we need some training to do so. But this is very, very useful in, and we have some experiences in some South American countries in small areas doing so. And this is very, very useful because most of the effects that we see in our crops are a result from the status of the soil. So if we know that the most important resource that we have for agriculture is our soil, we will try to keep it, we will try to improve it, and most what's most important, we will try to know it very well. And to know it, it's as simple as this. Just try to dig a hole in the ground frequently and get to know your soil. Afterwards, we can, of course, have additional tools to be more precise, knowing the relationship of the water and soil, and to evaluate soil and water dynamics. And what's most important for irrigation management or for management of water is being able to calculate soil balances, or at least to know how water enters, infiltrates in the soil, and when water is escaping from the roots beneath through this percolation, for example. And to carry out water balances, we need to know these dynamics of the water in the soil, and this we can do it through the field sensors. But the key information to manage water in agriculture is weather information, is weather data. And if I have to choose one or the other, the answer is very, very clear. Weather stations, open weather data is key to learn how to manage water in agriculture. And there's a before and after status in Spain and in Catalonia. Before and after, the farmers learn to manage weather data, open weather data. Their ability and their awareness on how important it is to manage water correctly improved a lot. I have no words to explain that, but it was really, really impressive. So this means that not only from a technical perspective, also from the impact perspective, seeing what happens when farmers have open access to open data about weather data about what happened, for example, in the last week, and also to the weather forecast in a more advanced way. So Which is the collaborative opportunity from this experience? To set up a network of sensors, mainly of weather stations, to have open data available everywhere. I assume that in a country that is frequently hit by severe phenomena, there's a lot of open information in that way. But maybe, for example, I know that in some Latin American countries, this is a constant fight, because there are networks of weather stations, but the information is closed. The farmers cannot access that information easily, and this is what needs to change. But as you know, any kind of information means power. So the people managing this kind of information or this kind of data are sometimes reluctant to put it in an open way. Anyway, besides the soil auger, the well stations are the best tool that we have to learn how to manage water in agriculture. And which information can we extract from this? Well, this is an example of a graph in which we are combining a field sensor that marks the water volumetric content in the soil and the precipitation and drainage that we set up in our project. In this case, this data is from one of our projects in Colombia. And we use this data to learn managing water in a maracuyá crop in volcanic soils in the Andean region, because there were no data in the literature about water needs of this kind of crop and in this kind of Andean soils. And the information that we have, as you see, we always have a pattern. This is a crop, this is a field without irrigation, so we can see, we can make a deduction about how our crop is entering the water stress periods and how they are trying to recover after rain starts again. We are going to see a little bit further on this in a moment. And another tool that we have is the remote sensing data. And why I mention this, because we already have open tools, open data, free, and any farmer can manage remote sensing data regardless the size of their farm. This is now a reality. You can find several tools in the market at very, very cheap prices. Obviously working with satellite data, and the satellite data, the own satellite data is free, but managing this data requires somehow a bit of knowledge and expertise to do so. But the collaborative opportunity, and this is mainly why I mentioned this technology today, is that from the perspective of a public administration or a research institute or even a university, it's very, very easy to provide farmers with a service that consists of managing this data for an entire region, because the raw information, the raw data from the satellites is free of charge, and you can do lots of things with this free data. So we've done a lot of things also in this way, and I'm gonna show you a couple of examples later. Afterwards, when it comes to pest and disease management, please remember that we are still at this first point of data gathering, and we are reviewing how can we gather data in an somehow easy way from a collaborative perspective. And this is why we are reviewing these tools today. When it comes to pest and disease management, this is tricky. This is really tricky, and this is somehow more difficult than the other issues or the other variables that I mentioned before. And why is that? Because you know that pests and diseases have an incidence that depend on a lot of factors. We know that weather is very important for this, but weather is not 100% the information that we need. So the systems, the collaborative systems that are working and that are helping farmers, especially in that countries with disaggregated agricultural areas that are far from one another, consist of collaborative solutions. Maybe this kind of surveys this kind of apps that you can have on your phone or in a tablet, and you have the location of your farm introduced in your profile, and 1 week after the other one, you just put in the survey the incidence of the different pests and diseases that you have in your farm. Afterwards, the information is centralized, and you can draw this kind of heat maps to show how pests and diseases are advancing. There are certain experiences doing so. I know a very, very nice company in Colombia that is doing this kind of services. But I think that it's a thing that can be easily replicated and can work even for disaggregated agricultural areas, because even though a pest may not have the same incidence really in one island or the other one, the system and the management of this information can bring lots of things, of interesting things to farmers to learn even how to collaborate, to share information. And we're going back to this again. And when it comes to validation and analysis, let me show you just one example of how we can manage together this kind of information that we mentioned previously, soil data, humidity of soil, and precipitation and drainage. What we see here is data from that project that I mentioned before in Colombia. And in Colombia, we, in final of 2015 and the beginning of 2016, we had a very severe event of the El Niño phenomenon with a very severe drought. And some months later, the drought came back. So we could monitor what happened with the soil humidity, with precipitation, with drainage, and with the crops, obviously. And what we see is that we found two areas or two moments with severe water stress. And at the other periods, if you see these black lines, which mark the drainage, drainage in that area, in the Caldas department in Colombia, is important because it rains a lot there, normally. And what happens when you have a volcanic soil and a lot of rain, that you have nutrient leaching, especially nitrogen leaching in a very, very important amount. Always when it's raining. So this means that if we are considering the possibility of implementing irrigation technologies here, in 2013 we came to that area. We started working in the Andean area in Colombia, and when we got there, and we started talking about irrigation equipment, very, very simple irrigation equipment. Farmers were like, you don't know what you are. Here we have rain of 2000 millimeters per year, so there's no need for irrigation here. And what we said is, you don't have to think of irrigation only for drought periods. You have to think of irrigation also as a technique to apply in an intelligent way nutrients, because if you can apply fertilization very easily, if you can spread nutrients through your farm in an easy way through the fertigation equipment, you can prevent this leaching and you can take advantage of a more efficient way of nitrogen dosing, for example. Okay, and this is the way to go. This is really the way to go. Luckily or happily, a couple of years later, the general perspective in that area had changed, and now, until December of last year, because we haven't had the chance to be there this year, you know, because we are stuck, we cannot travel. what we enjoy the most in our sessions is are the breaks, because these are the moments in which we farmers come to explain their experience, their new experience with these very simple irrigation or fertigation devices, from artisanal ones, from the materials that they have. They try to set up very simple irrigation devices, and they see that this works, because these severe droughts are coming more and more often every year. So they are starting to take it seriously, and they are seeing that this technology really works. But as we will see later, awareness is the base for everything. And then we have the decision support systems that are kinds of platforms and tools that can help us to manage a lot of data in a similar way, or all together to combine different layers of data. This is one of decision super systems that is in the market that we developed for ourselves, but now it is also at the market, and which is the collaborative opportunity that we can see here to develop open services, open decision making, linked to data gathering. Why linked to data gathering? Because decision super services that are really useful have a strong linkage with farmers. And this collaborative data gathering can lead later to these collaborative decision support systems. So I see both things as two different and subsequent steps. I wouldn't recommend to start building a decision support system if we don't have previously a collaborative data gathering system before, because the farmer's engagement is also very different in that situation, okay? And moving on to the actuation, just to mention the example that I stated before about irrigation and fertigation equipment. You see that we have three different steps, subsequent steps for irrigation and fertigation, which are water storage. If I don't store water, I won't be able to apply it afterwards. So to store water, the first thing that I need is the consciousness or the awareness that I need to store water, that I need to keep water. This is very, very important. And this was the first fight that we had with farmers in that department of Colombia, where it rained 2,000 millimeters per year. But we showed through the water balances week by week in an entire year that even you can have 2,000 millimeters of rain, there were certain periods during the year with water stress, where the plants were subjected to water stress. And for example, in crops like maracuyá, which is very, very sensitive in the flowering stage, if you have a drought in flowering stage, you have 5 months without any yield. This is very, very important. So the first step is being aware that we need to keep to store water. And afterwards, we will be able to apply this water to our fields. The fertigation control can be very, very, very simple. So you only need a faucet, a manual faucet if you want, just to open and close the water when you think that your crop is needing it. Obviously, we can have more complex equipment. We can have these pumps and filters and the controllers and so on, but this is not mandatory. This is optional. The important thing is to keep water and afterwards to have a tape, a dripper line, a set of sprinklers, or wherever you want to apply this water. And which is the collaborative opportunity, since we know that especially in certain areas, it's very difficult for small farmers or for more family farms to keep or to store water, because it may be too much expensive for them to have a device to keep water. The small irrigation districts in which farmers collaborate to keep water are also an alternative to make this possible, to make this feasible. Okay, and then this is a trend that we have to integrate all the steps that we just saw in integrated platforms that allow us to do almost everything except the communication and collaboration. At least I don't know so far a system in the market that integrates also communication and collaboration tools together with all the other aspects or the other steps. And which is the collaborative opportunity here? I see this further. I don't see this even in a collaborative way in the near future, because it's very hard. Normally what you do is just bring the different pieces together in one system. But the important thing is the one that we are leaving behind here, if you see it, which is the communication and collaboration. So I believe far more in this kind of tools, which are specifically designed to foster communication and collaboration between farmers and advisors, and to build communities of farmers which can discuss the same problems that we have, and communities of advisors that can share their knowledge. This is one of the nice examples that I had the opportunity to know in the last months. I had a nice conversation with Fernando Barrera and Gabriela Quiroga from the ICA, which were inside the team that developed this AgriX app. I think that you can only find it through the iOS system. I don't really know that. If you are using Android, you can try. I think that it's still in a beta version, but it's a very, very interesting initiative devoted to show to the three pilot countries, which are Antigua and Barbuda, the Bahamas, and St. Vincent and the Grenadines, these locally adapted fact sheets that are guidelines to good agricultural practices for specific crops that you have in these three countries. And you have also a Telegram group for this community building, for farmers to get in contact or get in touch with each other, and to discuss also with advisors to get this knowledge. And also you have the red button to contact advisor if you have a severe problem in your farm. So you can contact there straightly through this app an advisor. And this is a collaborative tool that I think that is really, really the way to go to start implementing technology, because we can, as I said before, technology is optional, but communication and collaboration is not anymore. So I hope that you have a broad perspective of the tools that we can implement to tackle these climate change effects and to help adapting to these climate change effects in our farms. And let's move on to the second target, which is integrating these climate change measures into national policies, strategies, and planning. This is a completely different thing of what we saw for the first target, and this has to do specifically with this title, so with policies, with strategy, and planning. And I will try to show you very briefly some ideas on how we are trying to get the needs of the farmers upscaled into local and regional planning strategies, and also to the regional policies. And which is the key for that? If we recall the same structure out of this process, obviously we are going to focus in this communication and collaboration step, because the other things are less applicable here. So the challenge is to go from these collaborative tools, which are far more important these days than they were last year, for example, because due to the COVID-19 scenario, although we may be not far from the other actors of our community with which we have to work for developing these policies or these strategies, we cannot meet physically. So these collaborative tools are far more important today than they were 1 year ago. But the challenge is to go a couple of steps beyond these collaborative tools or using these collaborative tools to develop these collaborative strategies and to upscale these strategies into collaborative policies. And I will try to explain it in a very graphical way. What we say is that there's a misalignment, it's a systemic problem. There is a misalignment between the impact-driven innovation processes, and that is the innovation processes fostered by the big institutions that come from the global challenges, for example, the SDGs in general, and the institutions that from a top-down perspective develop strategies and policies to solve these global challenges. Sometimes these techniques, these aims, these objectives, and these manners, these ways are not applicable to the local circumstances or to the territorial challenges. So the needs of the farmers and the needs of the actors of one territory go in one way, and the top-down strategies and the top-down policies go in another one. So this leads to very hard ways to drive really impactful projects. So the thing is that policies must support farmers' actions to fight climate change, but these supported actions must be really feasible, achievable. So there's a need of this alignment of the top-down strategies and policies and the bottom-up needs of the territory. And how are we addressing this? Through a mechanism that is related to social innovation strategies that is called shared agenda. The shared agenda consists of defining a future vision shared by all the actors of the territory, and later on to draw the policies and the small projects that help us to walk this path towards this shared vision or this shared agenda. This is based on a couple of issues that I will try to pass very, very briefly. This is the multi-level perspective theory. You have lots of references if anybody is interested in this from the academic perspective. But the thing is that you have a global context that is pushing our system, our current system. If you see the green hexagon, the green hexagon represents our current system. We have different socio-technical systems, and each one of these systems work with their own rules and works with in the way that we are used to. But this global context pushes the system because we have global needs that we have to tackle. And the SDGs are one big example of this global context and this pressure to the current systems and this intention to change these systems. And at the same time, we have emerging innovations that can be aligned or not in the same way of the, as the global context. But through the shared agenda, what we try to do is to stick this alignment to help this current system to be reconfigured and to adapt it to the pressure of the global trends. And if you focus on the SDGs and if you focus on the SDG 13 in this case, you will see it very, very clearly. The current system is a fossil-based model and so on. And the desired systems and this innovation that we have to align have to do with all these measures about mitigation and adaptation, not only of agriculture, but also to other issues that have to do with this trend of trying to adapt and to mitigate climate change. So in the end, if we can adapt and align all these innovative processes, we will have a reconfigured, this green reconfigured system that you see at the right of the figure. And to do so, we need collaboration. Collaboration is key. And this is very this is the heart of the presentation for today. We need to work together in this quintuple helix perspective. We have to bring together the public administration, the economic actors, including the farmers and their associations and so on, every kind of economic actors, the academy, the universities, the research centers, these three elements belong to what the Dutch said 20 years ago, the golden triangle of innovation. But we have realized that it's not enough to make a real change in the system. We need to include also citizens from the very beginning of the innovation processes. And this is why we have to develop this shared vision all together, because the tools that we are going to use to foster this innovation must be supported on the opinions of all these actors. And last, from the rural perspective, we have to include also the territory, the land, because all the resources that we manage are linked to the territory. We say that our laboratory is the territory, so we have to include the territory or the people or the institutions that manage the territory inside these innovation processes. And if you see the figure at the right, the process goes to from detecting these opportunities and challenges for the territory up to these changes in the system. So we want to achieve a systemic change. And what does it mean? That we will develop, we will write down this shared future vision based in green economy instead of the fossil-based economy model that we have today. And we have to build this transition process. And inside this transition process, if we can set up this landscape, every single project, every single action, every single tool within this transition will help us to walk this path. We will have everything aligned. We don't have time to waste in this transition to this green model. So we have to work together. We have no resources to waste. And the way that we found to align every single innovation processes is this, trying to work all together in this quintuple helix approach from the very beginning. And you know that it's tough. You know that the objectives or the aims or of the private companies are not straightly aligned with the government or with the farmers. So there's a hard work to do, especially at the beginning of these experiments. But if we can do so, we will be able to tackle this global challenge through adapting it to the challenge of the territory. And this is this shared vision. We will be able to identify these opportunities within this challenge. The next step, once we have the opportunities identified, is to identify the obstacles, the barriers, the problems that are separating us to achieve these objectives, to take advantage of this opportunity. And afterwards, once we have the obstacles identified, we will start making action or proposing solutions and building solutions in a collaborative way to tackle these obstacles, to meet these opportunities and to face this challenge of the territory, which will be already aligned with this global challenge. The pictures that you saw in this presentation are from the first participative sessions that we had here in our territory that in the end I will try to describe very briefly to give you a general perspective of where we are, and I will try to show you that although we are very far in distance, our situations in certain aspects are not that different, because we are a 100% rural territory, and we share most of our social challenges today and in the near future as any other rural territory in the world. So before this final remarks, let's take a look at 13.3. The target 13.3, which is about education, awareness rising. And I am repeating it perhaps too much, but it's real for me. The most important thing about climate change is making people aware. This is the baseline for everything. If we cannot make people aware that we have to act, and this is very, very severe, we will have it very, very difficult, not only from an agricultural perspective, but also as a human race. So we need help to do so. And here, we need the academics to speak up, but also we need farmers to show other farmers from other parts of the world that this is real. So, and I'm coming back to this in a few minutes, but I will try to show it by this pyramid in which to tackle mitigation and adaptation, we have two pillars, which are this awareness and education. Education has to do with the perspective of the future generations or the current generations, if we are talking of higher education of, or of universities. But you know, my faith in this is far bigger than for my faith with other kinds of communities, because I truly believe that education can make a difference. And but the general awareness for the general public or the general population needs specific actions that are different from those with education. If we achieve awareness and education, these are the two pillars that sustain this capacity for adaptation. And we reviewed in the 13.1 target some tools that we have to help agriculture adapt to climate change. And only if we can address this capacity for adaptation, we will be able to build this capacity for mitigation, because there are different things. We will be forced to adaptation in one way or another, or at one pace or another. But adaptation is not an option. Mitigation means a higher degree of awareness. And this is why I'm saying that mitigation comes later. Maybe we can discuss a little bit further on this, because I am truly interested in getting the view of the people in the Bahamas and the Caribbean about this, because you have different situations and a different concern on what's adaptation and mitigation. And I'm truly interested on this, because as I said before, I think that in Europe and perhaps also in North America, we have a lot of things to learn from you and from your perspective, because adaptation is not an option, but the pace to adaptation depends on your awareness and your willingness to do really, to make a change, a real change, okay? So, and when it comes to education, we can split these needs or these possibilities in different kinds of education. When it comes to secondary school, the most important thing for me is building soft skills and this transversal capacity building to show children that, not children, but people in secondary school, that they will have to be resilient and adaptive to everything, not only to climate change, but this world of us is ever-changing, and we need to build these soft skills and these capacities from this secondary school and also from the primary school, although it's a bit more difficult. And the awareness raising has to be worked very, very hardly, in a very hard way from the secondary school to foster this deep understanding of the problem that we are facing together. When it comes to vocational training, this is interesting because we've had here interesting petitions of vocational training schools to tell them or to work with them in these new jobs from a technical perspective, from bio-based jobs on ecosystem services. You know, ecosystem services have to do with supporting services, provisioning services, regulating services and cultural services. This kind of services that come from the natural capital, the ecosystems, and there are a lot of new jobs that we all will need in the next years. And vocational training has a lot of things to reconfigure inside the schools to adapt to these needs in the near future. And when it comes to universities, it's more or less the same, but obviously with another level. And when it comes to universities, we have to talk about not only teaching, but only the research about these bio-based materials, the green technologies, and this social innovation methodology that I just mentioned. In fact, for me, it was a great discovery to know about these social innovation methodologies. So I'm an agricultural engineer. I'm a science man from a classical perspective. And once we started building the things that we do on these social innovation methodologies, the world changed for us. I discovered a brand new world, and I'm very, very happy with the things that we are achieving. And what I'm most happy is with the reaction of the farmers, with the implication, with the engagement of the farmers in the innovation processes. And this is thanks to these social innovation methodologies that I just learned 4 years ago, and that I'm just trying to learn a bit more every day. And when it comes to these specific challenges that you are facing in small island developing states, or I have listed some points that have to do with the fact that you are an island-based country, so you have some difficulties in addition to the others that we can have in other rural areas in the world. And these specific challenges have to do with logistics of the supply chains, because most of the bio-based value chains that have been implemented in last years in Europe are not being successful, just because they don't have ensured the logistics for the supply chain. And I think that in an island-based country, this can be even a more severe problem. So the solution, or the way we are trying to tackle this, is to set up semi-decentralized facilities just to achieve this pre-processing and a first or a preliminary matter that offers us this best value for mass unit. So when we have to transport mass, is not the raw material, because organic raw material, as you know, has a lot of components that are not interesting, you understand me, to be valorized or converted into or transformed into biomaterials. Another challenge that we have is this keeping this territorial balance, because when you set up value chains, you have to choose the location for every step of the value chain, and you have to be very clear on that. We have a huge opportunity in rural territories in the next years to implement bio-based business models and bio-based value chains. And this is because we have the raw matter, but the added value must be kept also in this rural territory, because otherwise we won't be able to succeed in this willingness for our people in rural territories to keep living there and to keep improving the territory. And this is why we need to develop this local-based business model, and this is very hard in a low-populated country. So this is also another specific challenge, because although we can have a very, very good design of the value chain, the implementation depends on the market. So if the market is small, the value chain has to fight against any inefficiencies, because otherwise the numbers won't allow the development of this value chain. And afterwards, and this is not only for the small island countries, this is valid everywhere in rural areas, we need specific and correct and done in a right way these bioresources availability reports. We need to identify and quantify the bioresources that can be valorized, because otherwise we won't be able to set up these new value chains if we work on something that we are estimating that we have. So the first homework for universities and research centers is this. We have to identify the bioresources that we have, and we have to quantify them, really. And afterwards, try to think of how we are going to implement these supply chains and the logistics of these supply chains, and to build these semi-decentralized facilities, very cheap to install and easy to install and to maintain also, because what we are trying to do is to have one of these pre-processing small plants in each farm. And this means that we need them to be cheap and easy to install and to maintain. This is also challenging for us. And when it comes to the capacity for mitigation, let me mention just a couple of examples. The first is a general one, and this is the trend on which we are working these days, which is the development of value chains based on biomaterials. And this is why, this is because we have to think that as soil and crops act as carbon sinks. So CO2 is stored, is trapped, is kept in soils and also in our crops. But if we implement bio-based business models based on bioenergy, what we are doing in the end is releasing again this CO2 to the atmosphere. Although it's true that from the general context, since the plants or these resources, when they grow, they will keep again or sequestrate again this CO2, the overall impact is less than with fossil fuels, of course. But we can go one step beyond, and this is just keeping this carbon that we have sequestrated in these carbon sinks in form of biomaterials. So the challenge is to develop these value chains, to develop these business models, to search for these biomaterials that can keep this carbon inside them to substitute the plastics and the fossil-based materials. This is a very, very broad. For example, we are working now with pig slurry and with co-manure to experiment so far in different ways to reach different kinds of bioplastics that can be used for different things. Let's put it this way, because I don't want to spend more time on this, but the general idea is goes this way. We are working with pig slurry, with co-manure, just to valorize this raw material into these plastics. And if we had wood in our territory, but we don't, we would be exploring the same path, but from this kind of resource, because we are trying to separate cellulose from the manure and afterwards exploring this route to convert it into plastic, for example. And this is another nice project that we have in this case in Colombia, which is a processing plant, a very, very simple processing plant that works 100% with solar energy. And this is used to dehydrate fruit and vegetables. And we are working in this project with women from a community that was affected by the conflict in Colombia, just to give them a chance to be economically independent and to empower these women of this community and to run this business. And we are also helping them now that the plant is already running, and we also have solar panels to have the electric power that we need to manage the irrigation equipment near the plant. So it's 100% working with solar energy. And we are helping these women also with promotion of the products. And now we are at this point, and this is a very, very nice project. And the thing is that I am using this example here today to show that we can do things to mitigate climate change through taking advantage of this solar energy and with very, very simple facilities and very, very cheap facilities. If you see the pictures, it is what it is. It is very, very simple and it's working finely. We work here with a local university to optimize the dehydration process. And we are treating their pineapple, mango, onions. Even we have had some experiments with a preparation to different kinds of ingredients to cook soups, for example, and so on. And this is really nice. And you can find the company, this starting company, which is run by this community of women in the social media. I think that they are in Facebook and on Instagram with the name Through the Toll. I can write it down later in the chat, and you will see there the experience. And this is running 100% with solar energy, and so it's really, really sustainable. You only need the fruit and the workforce to run the plant. Okay, and to the last targets of the SDG 13 are the 13A and 13B, and 13A has to do with this Green Climate Fund, with this 100 billion annual fund that developed countries must put on the table, and 13B has to do with how to take advantage of these funds to really build this capacity for the effective climate change related planning and management in these least developed countries, and specifically in these small island developing states, and including this focus on women and youth and local and marginalized communities. So let's recall a couple of things that we just saw in the other aspects. This is the scheme of the quintuple helix that we are using to build this open innovation process to align these global challenges with the territorial challenges. But among these five kinds of actors, we can focus on the ones that we have in any farm, in every single farm, which is the economic actor. A farmer is an economic actor, and building this awareness is also important, because in most cases farmers don't see themselves as economic actors, and this is a problem that we have. But farmers must see them as an economic actor and as a powerful economic actor that will be essential to take advantage of these new opportunities that we will have in the next years to drive these innovation processes to have real impact. The European Commission puts it very, very clear. They're saying that for several years, they have put lots of millions of euros on the table to foster innovation. And this innovation has led to advances in technology, but not to real impact on the economic and social aspects. So this needs to change. And when it comes to climate change, this is at the very, very forefront of the innovation processes. And we have to have it really, really clear. So every single farm, every single family farm has an economic actor, has a citizen, and has a land manager. Nobody, absolutely nobody has the capacity, has a better capacity to manage land and the territory as farmers. Farmers are the best land keepers. Farmers are the best land managers that we have. And public administration cannot assume straightly land management. So depopulation in rural areas is a problem for everyone in every country in the world. So if we focus in this kind of actors that we can find in any farm, we will realize that farmers are really the important helix in this open innovation to achieve this bio-based model in the future. Because farmers are at least three out of the five kinds of actors that we need. And from this perspective, we can build the strategies, or we can point out the important things related to these groups of people that we have to consider also inside the innovation or the open innovation processes, which is the women, youth, and marginalized communities. But what is more important before that is that farmers are protagonists. Farmers are really the important actors in this open innovation, even in the cases where we are not developing food-based value chains. If we are talking of other kinds of value chains, bio-based value chains, but not dealing with food, dealing, for example, with bioenergy or with biomaterials, farmers are the most important actor because they are managing the resources, okay? So we have to consider them. We have to empower them. We have to motivate them, to have them engaged. We have to make them see that they are really the important actor in all these kind of processes. When it comes to women, what are our challenges that we have to face in this kind of innovation processes? We have to empower women because women in not everywhere, but it is quite common that the population in rural territories start with women. Women are the first ones to leave rural territories. In a lot of countries, in a lot of rural regions in the world. So we need to empower women. We need to empower their leadership. We need to give them tools to foster their entrepreneurship capacities. We have to motivate women to be entrepreneurs. This is not obvious and this is not easy because we need special focus on this. I think that if we can manage the leadership issues, if we can empower women, entrepreneurship comes after that. So it's more or less the same as I just said with farmers. We have to empower women to be leaders. And if they are empowered to be leaders, they will be entrepreneurs. They will be anything that they want to be, really. And these in some communities have to do also with ensuring their economic independence, their economic capacity. Women must be able to make a living of their work if they want to. This is the crucial aspect. And when it comes to youth has it, young people have their own challenges, but mainly if we consider it from a more technical perspective, I'd say that we have to focus on this bio-based job and the ecosystem services jobs, because they are quite different from the traditional jobs. And we have to empower youth by teaching them that these jobs will be every time more important. And when it comes to marginalized communities, we have to integrate them also in open innovation. We cannot leave them behind, because we are discovering in a lot of places. I have had the opportunity to work with regional and with public bodies in this setup of the open innovation processes in some countries in Latin America. And in those countries in which there's more tradition in rural communities, once we can integrate these specific communities into the overall process, things start to speed up. So it's very, very important to have them also inside these open innovation processes. And in most cases, this also means building, helping them build this own confidence, because they have to see them as important actors, as in the case of farmers. And in the case of marginalized communities, we have an additional challenge, which is breaking this digital gap. We cannot leave anybody behind with digital technologies. This is very, very important. And when I mean, when I say here digital technologies, I mean at least the basic digital technologies, because communication has to do with this. Communication goes through digital technologies nowadays. So if we want them to collaborate, to be really engaged, the first thing that we have to do is break this digital gap. And just to finish the presentation, let me show you or let me explain you that in our experience, in our territory, these open innovation processes have led to a really big impact in the smart specialization strategy, which is the strategies that in Europe, the regions built to direct the funding for innovation processes in a 7-year period. So I can tell you today that the smart specialization strategy of Catalonia, which will be unveiled next year, because it is for the 21-27 period, has taken into account the work that we did with farmers. Provided that the farmers have an active role, we have been able to take these ideas, to take these priorities of the farmers and upscale these priorities to a regional strategy. This regional strategy, which is only a political thing, will take into account the opinions and the collaborative work that was won from farmers from our area. And most of them, I can assure, they are little family farmers. But working together and being engaged in this collaborative open innovation process, we have been able to set these priorities inside this smart specialization strategy, which will be a definitive way to really support these innovation processes in the rural territories in the next 7 years. And another nice thing is that this process is listed as one of the inspirational initiatives for the European Network for Rural Development as a bioeconomy case study. And this is not based on the results that we have achieved so far. This is just because the ability that we have to engage farmers together with the public administration, with the academia, with the research centers, with the territory, and with all the other actors of the Quintuple Helix. And there's a fact sheet in the webpage of the European Network for Rural Development. You can see that how we manage the process, which is in fact the things that I have shown you today in this presentation. And just to finish, let me state how can we get started in a rural community. So let me set this challenge for you, for the people that is listening to me today. And this challenge is based on an experiment that we carried out last year in the university. I'm a part-time lecturer at the University of Lleida. And I had a very nice guy, a very nice student doing his final degree work with me. And we tried to set up this experiment to start this open innovation process with the farmers and the actors that we only had only in one city, only in Lleida, which is 140,000 inhabitants, a city, and the city is surrounded by farms and by family farms. And we set up one of these processes with representatives of the sub-regional administration, of the regional administration, of the local administration, of with representative of the university, of research centers. And it was a really nice experience, and it's going on. We are still working with these farmers. It all started with a 3-hour session in which they were working with some dynamics to identify the problems and opportunities of their surrounding environment based on this transition perspective, okay? And when we got the results of the survey that we sent when we finished the activity, the thing that they appreciated the most was the ability to sit down in small groups, in small working groups, with some activities, discussing with the technical manager of the Department of Agriculture about their day-to-day problems. And we are a small area. We are really a small area, but farmers don't keep in touch with this level of technicians and of researchers and so on very often. So there were a number of small projects that were born this day in this three-hour session. So this is an idea that I leave on the table for you, and obviously I will be more than happy to assist you or to help you in implementing this, because I truly believe in this. I truly believe that we can do a change for people. I truly believe that the way to make a change for people is starting slow and with small communities, making a real change for small communities. And you know, Shakara, that we were talking about different projects that we had in different regions, and it was kind of nice because I know that you have the same touch on this. The thing is starting little by little, making a real change for a small community, and afterwards you can think of upscaling a project. But you have to focus on real impact for a small community to make a change for their living. And just to give you this context, you will see that although we are very far and we have a different context, this is the place where I live, and this is the place where I work in this kind of open innovation processes, the Lleida province. You see that in area is quite similar to the Bahamas, and in population is also quite similar, and this leads to a similar density. So we are 100% rural. We are considered a rural territory within the European classification. Obviously, you have the difficulty of being split in several 700 islands, okay? So this makes things far more difficult. But you will see that even in the case of the largest cities, our capital, Lleida, is less populated than Nassau, and the second largest city in the entire province has 17,000 inhabitants. This is the second largest city in the entire province, so this is our reality. We have a very disaggregated population in this territory, so this is also a challenge for us. And we are focusing on that collaborative tools these days, because even though we are closer to each other than in your case, this COVID-19 strike has been very hard to these collaborative processes, because all these collaborative processes are built on confidence. So if we cannot build this confidence between the actors, everything gets tough. And we are trying to get this confidence through the collaborative tools, but it's not the same. So I would have enjoyed a lot to be there with you today, giving this presentation, because everything gets easier. And always when we have the chance to speak to each other close, face to face, we find new opportunities to go on working together. And this is very hard these days because we cannot meet to each other. So we have to focus on additional ways to build this confidence. And we have to think that we are used to set up projects and innovation, and it's the same for universities, for researchers. But in most cases, the companies and farmers are not used to enter, to be engaged in these processes. So you have to convince them that this is worth, and this confidence is really, really crucial for these first steps. So sorry about being late, because as you see, I've taken far more time than I wanted to, but this is what I had for you today. And if there's any question, I will be more than happy to answer it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Falguera. I mean, your presentation, you did not disappoint. Very thought-provoking, and I'm sure I have a lot of questions, and I'm excited about the work you've done, and I'm excited about the work we can do in the country and in the region just by working together. I mean, that really hit home for me about communication and collaboration is not optional. And I'm going to use that every single time I speak now. It's not an option. We have to communicate. We have to collaborate and work together. So we have a question here. I'm going to allow Manuel Lucina to ask his question. He has his hand up. Mr. Lucina, can you unmute your mic? Your question? Is Messina there? Can he hear us? Did I unmute him? Did I do something wrong? Let me see here. If you can hear us, unmute your mic. Just type in the chat here. But whilst we're waiting for Mr. Messina, we had a couple of questions here. The first of which is, yes, you have a question?
Maybe I put the hand up by mistake because my battery is almost dead. But I was commenting initially that, well, we'll have to talk because all what he's presented is just like falling from heaven. We are working something similar, like a pilot project for one of the countries in the Caribbean that with the intention to do it something country by country or maybe a regional network. And of course, it also, as he pointed, kind of match with what we're doing with the AgriX app. And so we'll have to talk further about this. Yeah. Sorry, I don't.
Sorry, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Messina. Another question we have with Mr. Thompson says, are there any plans to bring these technologies to the Caribbean region? And I had that question, wrote that question down. So how can we work more closely together? How can we collaborate together in your region as well as in the Caribbean? What would be your recommendations? Would it be through universities, through farmers groups? How can we make that happen?
Well, the first thing about technology is that everything that I showed today is already available and can be straightly implemented. But it's true that in some cases you will need to find a way to drive the technology. But the technology itself is not the problem because technology is every day more accessible for everybody. For example, think of the satellite data. The only thing that you need is one technician to receive a 5-hour training. And we could do this training because we do this kind of precision agriculture courses every week, more or less. You will learn to download the data, to process the data, and to have the maps for every single farm that you have in your country, because the raw data is open access, and it's not difficult. In a 4 or 5 hour course, you can learn to do so. Maybe we could I don't know if I'm saying something inappropriate, and sorry about that, but maybe we could do a webinar on how to download the open data and how to build the maps, for example, because it's very, very easy. And the second question about collaborating, well, absolutely yes. So I'm working with a number. I'm very, very lucky with this because I enjoy it a lot. I'm working with a number of South American countries in different aspects, but in terms of territorial development based on this social innovation, we are starting with similar experiences. For example, in the border with Ecuador and Peru. And this is an example, but yes, you will have my contact, or you can contact Shakara and Jerry, and I will be more than happy to explore the ways for collaboration anywhere.
Thank you very much. I've been told that we're getting running out of time, but I just definitely want to say thank you for acknowledging the value of women in the equations. She appreciates that as one of our women farmers on our Neem farm in Apico. So she says she wants to appreciate that. So with that, I'm not able to take any more questions, but just want to say that the AgriX app is available in the Apple Play Store as well as on Android. So you can go to the Google Play Store and download AgriX app. And we're getting ready to launch that very soon. Jerry and I are responsible for that. So we're going to launch that in the Bahamas very soon. We have some of the farmers who are part of the consultation process and we're putting that together. So also that we have a project under Jeff, UNDP, full size, that will be written in the concept note phase, and it's on their website. So if you want to look that up, we have a lot of good things coming up in terms of food production and land degradation management. So thank you very much, Dr. Fungera, for your presentation. And it's showing on Facebook and YouTube and every other platform that I can put it on, or we can put it on, and people can go back and rewatch it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Look forward to
Thank work. You. Thank you.
Thank you to everyone for attending. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Shakara. Thank you, Jerry. And I'm looking forward to seeing you again very, very soon, and to go on with any kind of collaboration that you want, and to also knowing more about these projects that you just mentioned, because you know that I am very, very interested in the things that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for watching.
Yes, have a good evening. Can I have a good afternoon to everybody?
You too.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.